Asher Digital presents Overture to Death by Ngaio Marsh, read by Anton Lesser. Jocelyn Jerningham was a good name. The seventh Jocelyn thought so as he stood at his study window and looked down the vale of Pen Cuckoo, overlooking the Cloudyfold woods. Here seven generations of Jerninghams have stood and looked over their own tilth and tillage. What precisely, father, said his son, Henry Jerningham, is tilth? No feeling among the present generation, said Jocelyn angrily. I'm 23. If I marry Dinah, absurd suggestion. Henry joined his father and looked down into the austere landscape, adamant between drifts of winter mist. The few stone cottages, with their signs of blue smoke, were the only waking things in the valley. I too love Pen Cuckoo, said Henry, and we are not discussing a possible misalliance. There have been Copelands at the rectory for as many generations as there have Jerninghams at Pen Cuckoo.
You're both much too young, began Jocelyn.
No, really, sir, that won't do. You mean if it had been someone richer, you and dear cousin Eleanor wouldn't talk about youth.
Pen Cuckoo means more to me than anything. You know as well as I do that we're damned hard up. Those cottages at Cloudyfold, winter'll leak like a basket if we don't fix the roof. The point is,
I can't afford to make a poor marriage. Well, Dinah won't always be the poor parson's one ewe lamb.
What do you mean?
Asked Jocelyn, uneasily, pricking up his ears. Miss Campanula has left all her filthy lucre to the rector, as you must have heard.
Servants' gossip, muttered the squire. Anyway, she may change her mind. It's now we're so damned hard up.
Let me find a job, said Henry. You have a perfectly good agent.
Nonsense.
Look here, father, said Henry, gently. Let's recognise Eleanor's hand in this. The scene which Eleanor so conveniently overheard yesterday in the rectory by standing in the hall to listen sent her clucking back to you like a hen.
You've never been fair to Eleanor. She's done her best to take your mother's place.
For God's sake, said Henry violently.
Don't use that detestable phrase. Cousin Eleanor is an ageing spinster of the worst type. To come to Pen Cuckoo was her golden opportunity. She's a vulgarian. On her mother's side, said Jocelyn, she's a Jerningham.
Oh, my dear father, said Henry, and burst out laughing. Jocelyn began to stammer.
Eleanor, unavoidably, overheard, no question of eavesdropping, believed to be her duty.
If Dinah loves me, said Henry, setting the Jerningham jaw, I shall marry her. Eleanor dramatizes herself as the first lady of the district, the squiress, the chatelaine of Pen Cuckoo. She sees Dinah as a rival. She's jealous, and it's rooted in sex.
Balderdash, said Jocelyn.
But he looked uncomfortable.
No,
cried Henry, it's not. Eleanor was in love with you until she found it a hopeless proposition. Now she and her girlfriend, the Campanula, are rivals for the rector. Everybody sees it. Dinah says old maids always fall in love with her father. It's Eleanor, Eleanor, Eleanor who is to blame for this.
Did I hear you call me, Henry?
Asked a quiet voice. Miss Eleanor Prentice came into the room and switched on the lights.
Almost time for our little meeting, said Miss Prentice.
She walked with small, mimbling steps towards the cherrywood table and began to place pencils and paper. Between her thin, closed lips, she produced a dreary, flat humming. To stop the noise, Henry asked, What meeting, Cousin Eleanor?
The Entertainment Committee, the Rector and Dinah, Dr. Templet, Idris Campanula, and ourselves. We are counting on you. And Dinah?
Eleanor Prentice was a thin, colourless woman of perhaps 49, disseminating the odour of sanctity to an extent that Henry found intolerable. Her perpetual half-smile suggested that she was of a gentle and sweet disposition, which was a mistake. She and Henry shared a certain hard determination which each recognised in the other. In Henry, this was tempered by courtesy and a generous mind.
Your study is almost my favourite corner of Pencuckoo, Jocelyn, she said brightly.
Henry said, But you're very fond of every corner of the house, aren't you, Cousin Eleanor?
Yes, she said softly. I used to spend my holidays here. Remember, Jocelyn? I love the dear old home.
It's a pity that when I marry Cousin Eleanor, I shan't be able to take my wife to Winton. I can't afford to mend the roof, you know.
Winton is the Dower House, of course, murmured Miss Prentice.
As you already know, Henry said, I have begun to pay my addresses to Dinah Copeland. He saw her eyes narrow, but she smiled a little more widely, showing her prominent and unlovely teeth.
I thought it my duty to speak to your father, Henry.
Why?
I think, dear, that two young people are in need of a little wise guidance.
There's the rectory car now, coming round the cloudy-fold bend, said Jocelyn from the window. You'd better tell us what this meeting's all about, Eleanor.
It's the young people's friendly circle, she said. We badly want funds, and the rector suggested we might get up a little play. You've always loved acting, Jocelyn, and you're so good at it. Do you remember Ici on parle français in the old days? Dr. Templet is very good at theatricals, and dear Idris Campanula is all enthusiasm.
Good Lord, ejaculated Henry and his father together. What on earth is she going to do? Asked Jocelyn.
Now, Jocelyn, we mustn't be uncharitable, said Miss Prentice with a cold glint of satisfaction.
I'm too old, said Jocelyn.
Nonsense, dear.
I'm damned if I'll make love to the Campanula, said the squire ungallantly.
Eleanor assumed her usual expression for bad language, coloured by complacency.
What's Dinah going to do? Asked Henry.
Well, as dear Dinah is almost a professional.
She is a professional, said Henry.
Such a pity, said Miss Prentice. I'm old-fashioned enough to think the stage is not a profession for a gentlewoman, Henry, but of course if she isn't too grand for our humble efforts.
A car pulled up, and two cheerful toots sounded on an out-of-date klaxon.
I'll bring them in, said Henry.
Taylor, the butler, appeared and took the rector's shabby overcoat. Henry dealt with Miss Campanula's furs. She was a large, arrogant spinster with a firm bust, a high-coloured complexion, coarse grey hair and enormous bony hands. Her clothes were hideous but expensive, for Idris Campanula was extremely wealthy. She was Eleanor Prentice's great friend, based on mutual antipathies and interests, scandal cloaked by a mantle of conscious rectitude. Neither trusted the other an inch. Eleanor never relinquished her air of charity, but Idris prided herself on her outspokenness. The rector, a widower whose classic handsomeness made him the prey of such women, was secretly terrified of both. When Henry, who had known Dinah all his life, returned to Pencuckoo from Oxford and a course with a volunteer air reserve unit, Dinah had gotten into the tail end of a small repertory company for 6 weeks. The company then fell to pieces and Dinah returned home, an actress. 3 weeks ago, he had met her on the hills above Cloudyfold and fell in love. Yesterday, in the shabby, charming old drawing room at the rectory, he began to speak. Then they had seen Eleanor in the dark hall beyond. Now he said, Dinah?
Henry?
When can I see you alone?
Is anything wrong?
Eleanor.
Oh, Lord, said Dinah.
I must talk to you. Above Cloudyfold, where we met that morning, tomorrow, before breakfast.
All right, said Dinah.
Idris Campanula marched into the study, shook hands with Jocelyn, and exchanged pecks with Eleanor Prentice, who said,
Dr. Templet hasn't arrived yet.
He is up beyond Cloudyfold, the rector said. Old Mrs. Thrin is much worse, and the third cane boy managed to drive a nail through his big toe. I am to ask you not to wait.
Beyond Cloudyfold?
Asked Miss Prentice sweetly. Henry saw her exchange a glance with Miss Campanula.
Mrs. Ross doesn't have tea till 5, said Miss Campanula. I only hope he doesn't try to get her into our play,
said Miss Campanula.
Beatrice, dear, said Miss Prentice, collecting their attention. May I? This is just to be among ourselves. I have several little plays here for 5 and 6 people, and I fancy Dinah has found some too.
6 people, said Miss Campanula. We've 3 ladies and 3 men. Now, if the rector...
No, said the rector.
If there's any help I can give behind the scenes, I shall be delighted, but I shall not appear. 6, said Miss Campanula.
Certainly no more, said Miss Prentice.
Well, said the squire, if Mrs. Ross is good at acting...
No, Jocelyn, said Miss Prentice.
She is very attractive, said Henry.
Has she had any experience? Said Dinah.
My dear child, said Miss Campanula loudly, she's common as dirt and we don't want her. I have seen Eleanor's plays and I fully approve of Simple Susan. There are 3 men and 3 women, no change of scene, and the theme is suitable.
It's rather old, said Dinah dubiously.
My dear child, repeated Miss Campanula, if you think we're going to do one of your modern plays, you're very greatly mistaken.
Some of the modern pieces are really not quite suitable, agreed Miss Prentice gently.
And as for Celia Ross, said Miss Campanula, I think we'll be doing a Christian service to poor Mrs. Templet, who we all know is an invalid, if we give Dr. Templet something to think about. Besides...
Come, said the rector desperately.
Nobody has suggested Mrs. Ross be asked to take part. They'd better not, said Miss Campanula.
The door was thrown open by Taylor, who announced,
Mrs. Ross and Dr. Templet, sir.
An extremely well-dressed woman and a short, rubicund man walked into the room.
Hello, hello, shouted Dr. Templet. I brought Mrs. Ross along. She's a perfectly magnificent actress. I know you'll be delighted.
Henry rescued the situation. Neither Miss Campanula nor Miss Prentice made the slightest attempt at cordiality. The squire shouted,
What?
And broke into uncomfortable social laughter. Diana greeted Mrs. Ross with nervous civility. The rector followed his daughter's example. Henry, filled with a vague desire to be nice to the entire world, shook Mrs. Ross warmly by the hand, greeted Dr. Templet, and suggested they should at once elect a chairman and decide on a play. Miss Prentice, smiling a little more widely than usual, said,
We are short one chair.
I'll share Dinah's chair,
Henry said happily.
Please don't get one for me, said Mrs. Ross. Billy can perch on my arm.
She settled herself composedly on the rector's left, and Dr. Templet at once sat on the arm. Miss Prentice had already made sure of herself on the rector's right, and Miss Campanula, defeated, uttered a short laugh and marched to the far end of the table. Henry, his father, and Dinah took the remaining chairs. A strong light shone on the squire, pink with embarrassment. Miss Prentice, smiling, Miss Campanula breathing through her nostrils like an angry mare, Henry's dark, Jerningham features, Dinah's crisp and vivid beauty, the rector's coin-sharp priestliness, and Dr. Templet's hearty, undistinguished normality. It shone on Celia Ross, a straw-coloured woman of perhaps 38. She was not beautiful, but her hair curved back from her forehead in pale waves, her thick white skin was beautifully made up, and her clothes were admirable. Her eyes were pale, the lashes almost white when left to themselves. Mrs. Ross was a little like a ferret, but she had a quality that arrested the attention of many women and most men. She was a coarse-grained woman, but she seemed fragile. Her manner was gay and good-natured, but her tongue was quietly malicious. Her chief interest was men. Dinah could not help admiring the cool assurance with which she met her frigid reception. She has got a cheek, thought Dinah. She looked at Henry and saw her own thoughts reflected in his face. He met Dinah's glance and his expression changed into one of such vivid tenderness that her heart turned over. She was brought back by the sound of Miss Prentice's voice.
To elect a chairman, I should like to propose the rector.
Second,
said Miss Campanula in her deepest voice.
There you are, Copeland, said the squire. Everybody say aye.
The rector looked amiably around the table.
Thank you very much. We have only to settle the date and nature of this entertainment. Perhaps I should explain that the Young People's Friendly Circle, which has done such splendid work in Pencuckoo, need a new piano. As we all know, Miss Prentice is president and Miss Campanula is secretary. I believe the present instrument was the gift of your father, Squire.
Yes, said Jocelyn. I was about 12. It wasn't new then. The tuner says he can't do anything more with it, said Miss Campanula. I blame the scouts. They have no discipline, and they've gone from bad to worse. On Saturday, I found Georgie Biggins trampling up and down the keyboard in his boots and wanging the wires inside with the end of a pole.
Dear me, said the rector mildly. I have suggested whatever is raised by this entertainment to be devoted to a piano fund. There's a good instrument at Priest's in Great Chipping. The price is £50.
We can't hope to make that, can we? Asked Dinah.
I'll make up any difference, said the squire.
There was a gratified murmur. Miss Prentice seemed to preen herself. Henry was startled by the singularly venomous glint in Miss Campanula's eye. Appalled, he thought, she's jealous of Eleanor taking glory from father's offer. The rector hurried them on. A date was fixed. Miss Prentice made quantities of notes. Every now and then, someone would steal a glance at the small pile of modern plays in front of Dinah and the larger pile of elderly French's acting editions in front of Miss Prentice. While they discussed admission prices and dates, through each of their minds raced their secret thoughts. The rector thought, I can't believe Templet. A medical man with an invalid wife. What persuaded him to bring her here? I wish Miss Campanula wouldn't look at me like that. I wish I'd never said confession was recognized by the church. I wish I didn't get the impression that she and Miss Prentice merely used the confessional as means of informing against each other. 6 parts and 7 people. Oh dear. The squire thought,
I was good in Ici en parle français. I wonder if it's true about Templet and Mrs. Ross. I'm as young as I ever was. What am I going to do about Henry and Dinah Copeland? Pretty girl. Modern. If only the Copelands were a bit better off. Blast and damn Eleanor. 6 parts and 7 people. Why shouldn't she be in it?
Henry thought, tomorrow morning I shall tell Dinah I love her. Why shouldn't Templet have his Celia Ross in the play? 6 parts and 7 people to the devil. Let's find a new play. I'm in love. Tomorrow morning, Dinah and I will be up on Cloudyfold. Dinah thought, tomorrow morning, Henry will be waiting for me above Cloudyfold, and there will be nobody in the whole world but Henry and me. Eleanor Prentice thought,
if I manage this well, it will look as if it's Idris who is making all the trouble, and he will think her uncharitable. 6 parts and 7 people. Idris is determined to stop the Ross woman at all costs. I shall be 49 next month. Idris is more than 49. Dinah should work in the parish. I wonder what goes on among actors. Dressing and undressing behind the scenes and travelling together. If I could find that Dinah had... If I married, Jocelyn would make me an allowance. To see that woman look at Templet like that, and he at her. Dinah and Henry. I can't bear it, I can't endure it. Never sure you're hurt. I want to look at him, but I mustn't. Henry might be watching. Henry knows. Parish priest should be married. His head is like an angel's. No, not an angel. A Greek god. Prostrate before thy throne to lie and gaze on thee. O God, let him love me.
Templet thought,
I'll have to be careful. I suppose I was a fool to bring her, but she was so keen on acting, it was the only thing to do.
If those two staffed spinsters get their teeth into us, it'll be all up with the practice. Oh, I wish to God my wife wasn't what she is. It'd be the same if she wasn't. Celia's got me. It's like an infection. I'm eaten up with it.
Celia Ross thought.
So far, so good. I can manage the squire quite easily. He's got his eye on me already. The boy's in love with a girl, but I think he'll be generous. He's no fool. I rather fancy he's summed me up. Attractive. Might be amusing to take him from her. Doubt if I could. He's past the age where they fall for women a good deal older than themselves. It was fun coming in with Billy and seeing those two frostbitten old virgins with their eyes popping out of their heads. They're trying to see if Billy's arm is touching my shoulder. The Campanula is staring quite openly, and the poor relation's looking out of the corner of her eyes. I'll lean back a little. There. I've never felt like this about any other man. It's as if we'd engulfed each other. I won't have him in their schoolroom play without me. He might have a love scene with a girl. I couldn't stand that. 7 people and 6 parts. Now then. Idris Campanula thought, if I could lay my hands on that woman, brazen effrontery, I've always suspected Dr. Templet. If Eleanor had the gumption of a rabbit, she'd have forbidden them the house. He's practically got his arm around her. It amounts to lying in open sin. The rector can't let it pass. It's an open insult making me sit at the same table. Every hand is against me. I've no friends. They only want my money. Eleanor's as bad as the rest. She's tried to poison the rector's mind against me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.